Welcome to Virginia Union University's Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology weekly service of worship and prayer in Colburn Hall, inside the Alex Bledsoe James Memorial Chapel. Welcome.
Come on, everybody, clap your hands a little bit. We came to lift up the name of the Lord. Let the world know that every praise is to our God. Come on, let's say it one good time. Here we go. Come on, VUU, let's do it. Every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship.
Every word of worship.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
To our God.
Sing hallelujah.
To our God. Every praise,
every praise,
to our God. Come on, let's take it up.
Every praise
to our God.
Every word of
worship.
Whoa.
Our God.
Glory.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise. To our God. Come on.
God.
Come on. Let's go up one more time.
Every praise.
To our God.
Every word of worship.
Whoa. Come on, give it to me in harmony.
Sing hallelujah,
sing hallelujah
to our God.
Glory.
Glory, hallelujah, is to our God.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
To our God.
Is to
our God. Come on, clap your hands, all you people.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Come on, give it to me in harmony. God, my Savior.
God, my Savior.
God, my healer.
God, my healer.
God, my deliverer. Come on.
God, my deliverer.
Yes, he is.
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 Every praise, come on.
Every praise,
every praise.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise,
every praise,
every praise
is to our God.
Clap your hands, come on.
Whoa.
Every praise,
every praise,
God bless you.
Amen. Our scripture for today comes to us from 2 Chronicles chapter 20. I'm going to preach from the entirety of that book and that chapter, but for our purposes in this short amount of time, let me just read a few verses, beginning in verse 2. It reads this way: After this, the Moabites and Ammonites with some of the Mennonites came to wage war against Jehoshaphat. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. It is already in Tamar. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, Lord, the God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nation. Power and might are in your hand, and no one will withstand you. Our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. But now, here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territories we would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt, so they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. Our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. Here is our key verse. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. For our time together in chapel today, I want to preach from the subject, when we don't know what to do, when we don't know what to do. Family, it's been said that humankind's need for control fuels her craving for the certainty. I'll say it again, humankind's need for control fuels her craving for certainty. And so it can be an unsettling thing for us when we don't know what to do. The more I watch the television news, the more I check my social media and my timelines, the more I recognize that in the midst of this unique season of pandemic and protests and politics and policy reform, and even as pupils in the School of Theology, many of us see the challenges and obstacles before us. And if we be honest, we'd say in many cases, we don't know what to do. As a nation, it seems clear that we have to uproot some of the corruption and cruelty and carelessness of governmental leaders. But when we see all the forms of voter suppression, pivots in the postal system operations, and even the vast amount of people who seemingly seem to genuinely share the rhetoric, the politics, even white supremacist views that permeate the power halls of Washington, D.C., we can look around and say, Lord, we don't know what to do. As pastors and leaders of faith communities around the world, we are seemingly sparring on a weekly basis about re-entry plans and how and when to safely regather in our beloved sanctuaries for worship. And though each pastor has to hear from God for themselves, if you ask the few of us who are caught in this maze of endless pastoral group text message chats, medical advisory board meetings, and even Zoom conference calls, many of us would have to confess this morning, when it comes to pastoring in a pandemic, we don't know what to do. And even as students at our beloved STVU, when you consider that some of us could barely understand some of what our professors were saying while we sat in front of them in the classroom, now you're telling us we have to engage virtually when the pandemic has caused dips in our own pocketbooks, but tuition seems to be rising at the university. When we believed, we heard God calling us to this place in this season, and yet we are conflicted, confused, even challenged by some of what is being communicated to us by the institution we love. We can sit back, ponder this thing of sticking it out at seminary, and confess to ourselves, we don't know what to do. Family, if we're honest, there are times in our lives when our backs are up against the wall, and in the face of the vast challenges before us, we can feel outgunned, outmanned, out of time to fix or to conquer what troubles us. And the question that I need to ask you today, STVU, is what do you do when you truly don't know what to do? That's where Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah find themselves when we arrive at our text in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. For context, the book of Chronicles is a supplemental telling of the stories of the reigns of kings of Israel and Judah from the time of King David to the Babylonian Empire. And by the time of our text, the Davidic monarchy has split. The 12 tribes of Judah now find themselves in two distinct kingdoms: Israel, which controlled the northern parts of their territory and was comprised of 10 of the original tribes of Judah, are in the north. And in the southern kingdom of Judah, you have the two remaining tribes, the tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin. And at the time of our text, King Jehoshaphat rules the southern kingdom of Judah. He's come into power after the reign of his father, King Asa. And the chapter 17 tells us that the Lord is with him. He follows in the way of the Lord as David did. And because of that, God gives him wisdom. God gives him wealth. God gives him peace for the majority of his reign. That is until he marries into a family that causes him to forge some foreign and some fatal alliances that end up displeasing God. And in chapter 19, Jehoshaphat returns home from a failed military campaign that eventuates in the death of the king of Israel. And upon his return, there is a seer who warns the king in this way: should you help the wicked and love those who hate the Lord? Because of this, the wrath of the Lord is on you. There is, however, some good in you. For you have rid the land of the Asherah poles, and you have set your heart on seeking God. And by the time we get to chapter 20, we find that the king gets news that the enemy neighboring nations, the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Midianites, and shoot, maybe even the Shilites, have you seen her? They are all on their way. They've teamed up. They're headed towards he and his people for war. And in this time of tension, King Jehoshaphat, in a moment of transparency, says, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. And though time won't allow us to do a deep dive of this text today, I just want to come by for a couple of minutes to survey these few verses. And I want us to leave this virtual experience with a few lessons on what we ought to do when we don't know what to do. Let me give you a quick two and then I'll be through. The first thing that the text teaches us in this season when we don't know what to do is that you can't trash every tradition. That when you don't know what to do, you can't trash every tradition. It's right there, verse 1 through 4. After this, the Moabites, the Ammonites, with some of the Midianites, came to wage war against Jehoshaphat. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. It's already in Hazazon Tamar, that is in Gedi. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord. He proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town. Family, the text says that Jehoshaphat realizes he's up against some unexpected and some imbalanced odds. He's been informed that the armies coming against him already have made it close to him. Jehoshaphat doesn't have enough men. He doesn't have enough weapons. He doesn't have enough time to muster muster up a winning strategy. He is outmanned, outgunned, and out of time, and he does not know what to do. Or so he says, because the part of this text that blesses me, family, is that though he doesn't have any military tactics to pull from in a situation like this, he does maximize on some of the traditions that have helped sustain him through his reign. Verse 3 tells us that alarmed Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord. He proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. That when he doesn't have a clue and doesn't know what to do, Jehoshaphat doesn't consult with the best military strategists. He does not Google five ways to stop the Moabites. He doesn't even come up with a plan of his own, but he goes back to the bases, even in his alarmed state, and he pulls on the traditions of praying and fasting and consulting God that had seen him and his people through in previous problematic predicaments in the other chapters of his story. And it's a simple, but it's an important word today, both in our social political climate and for students and pupils here at STVU who may not know what to do in this season, because it seems to me that we are living in a climate where, as a society, we are increasingly pulling out our proverbial dumpsters and broomsticks, and we are discarding, we are throwing away, and we are trashing symbols and structures and practices that no longer seem to serve us or have been deemed destructive to our cultural and societal progress. We are living in a time of trashing some of the Confederate monuments and statues, calls for the trashing and abolishment of policing and prison systems, trashing our binary gender structures and what some perceive to be harmful forms of human identification. Even in churches, young and old members, seminarians, and those who are old school are rightly calling for the trashing of some of our theologies, our patriarchal systems, teachings and practices that seem to subjugate women, to perpetuate problematic patriarchal systems that demonize human desire, minimize the Messiah's mandate for justice, and put an asterisk on who God will love, who God will save, and who God wants to serve in God's kingdom. And if your seminary experience has been anything like mine, you may find yourself in classes like Old Testament or New Testament or systematic theology, where you're being called to look deeply at what you believe and why you believe it, and potentially you're getting ready to throw away some of the long-held and cherished beliefs to make room for what God could potentially show you, something new in the future. But I stopped by the virtual chapel today to say that there are absolutely some traditions and systems and ideologies in our government, in our legal system, yes, even in our churches, that may need to be trashed in this period where we don't know what to do. But please don't trash every tradition, because Jehoshaphat reminds us that there are some traditions, some practices that got our ancestors through. There are some traditions that got us through that still have power today when we don't know what to do. And I'm crazy enough to believe that prayer still works, that fasting still works, that meditation still works, that worship still works, that the right song at the right time will alter your spirit, that the word of God can change your heart, change your mind, set your soul on fire, and give you power to persevere. I need somebody to holler at me in the comment section and say, don't trash every tradition. I'm grateful for my grandmother, Mother Roberta. She didn't have a seminary education, but she knew when times would get rough and she didn't know what to do, how to call on Jesus. She'd tell me, have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles. He'll hear your faintest cry and answer by and by. Tell somebody, when you don't know what to do, don't trash every tradition.
I got to go. I told y'all, I'm going to give you two, and then I'm through. Number one, when you don't know what to do, you can't trash every tradition. But number two, you have to be willing to surrender to the sovereign's strategy. You have to be willing to surrender to the sovereign strategy. It unfolds for us, family, between verses 4 and 27. We don't have enough time for me to reread all of it, but can I give you the Cliff Notes version? King Jehoshaphat realizes that he is outgunned and out of time, and decides to go old school. He inquires of God through prayer and fasting. And the text says that he and all of Judah engage in this time of fasting and crying out to God together, in which Jehoshaphat finally confesses to the Lord in verse 12, "We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you." And after he appeals to the Lord, God responds to Jehoshaphat through the prophet Jehaziel with God's strategy in verses 15 through 18. God, Jehaziel says, he says, "Listen, King Jehoshaphat and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, march down against them. They will be climbing up by the pass of Zir, and you will find them at the end of the gorge in the desert of Jeruel. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your position, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you. Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Get out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you." Good googly moogly, that thing is juicy. After God speaks through Jehaziel, telling him the strategy that God has for their victory against the enemies, verse 24 tells us that the men of Judah surrender to God's strategy, and they show up right where God tells them to go, to the place that overlooks the desert, where they look towards the vast army that they are facing. And I'm going to confess to your family, it blows my mind that they show up here knowing that they're outmanned, knowing that they're outgunned, knowing that they're out of time, because of what God said the strategy for victory would be. Let me remind you of the strategy one more time. God says, "I want you to march against them tomorrow, find them at the edge of the gorge in the desert, take up your position, stand firm, see the salvation of the Lord." But here it is, you won't have to fight the battle. And in my sanctified imagination, I hear somebody saying, "Hold up, hold up now, God, hold up, King Jehoshaphat, this does not make sense." And I would argue that if we are honest, part of the reason that we can't always surrender to the sovereign strategy is because often what we discern God telling us to do doesn't make a whole lot of sense. God told the people, "You are outnumbered, you are outmanned, but show up to the battle anyway, and you're not even going to have to fight to win." God, that doesn't make sense. But when Judah shows up into the field at the appointed time, they find that all their enemies are already dead, and the plunder is waiting for them, because God confused the enemy armies into fighting one another before Judah ever shows up, and they get the victory just as God said they would, without having to fight. And they learned that day what I hear God saying to us in our day. God says, "I'm not always in the business of making sense, but I am in the business of making ways." I gotta go, SCVU. I hope that one day in the physical chapel we'll be together, but I just came by to tell somebody who doesn't know what to do in this season. You don't know what to do about going back to school this semester. You don't know what to do because your money doesn't match the tuition rate. You don't know what to do with the church that you're called to serve. I've come to give you one word today, and that is that when God responds to you, surrender to God's strategy. And the Lord says, "It won't always make sense, but I will make a way." We serve a God who nudged Jochebed to send her baby boy up the river to escape death at the hand of Pharaoh, only for the same God to flip that thing so that Jochebed Jochebed was paid to nurse Moses and rear her own child while getting paid in the palace. It won't always make sense, but God will make a way. When Moses and the Israelites found themselves stuck between the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army trying to kill them, Moses lifted his rod in obedience to God, and God turned the waters that blocked their escape into I-95 for the Israelites to cross into the promised land. Because God won't always make sense, but God will make a way. We serve a God who took two fish and five loaves of bread and made fish au filet sandwiches with extra tartar sauce for 5,000 plus in attendees with doggy bags to go around. Because we serve a God that won't always make sense, but God will make a way. And God, we serve a God who empowered Jesus to turn water into Moscato and Stella Rosa so that he could keep the party going. And when the people said, we need a savior, God said, listen, I know it doesn't make sense, but I want my son to go up on an old rugged cross. In their tradition, it was believed that those who were hung up on wood were a curse. It didn't make sense, but Jesus said, I kept on going. I kept on pushing, even though it didn't make sense, because I heard God say that if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men and all women unto me, and salvation will come, even when it doesn't make sense. I gotta go. I love your family. May the Lord God bless you real good. But when you don't know what to do, surrender to what the sovereign says. I've decided to follow Jesus. I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Because even when it doesn't make sense, God will make a way. Family, I love you. I know we're in a time where things don't make sense all the time. And when you don't know what to do, I want you not to trash every tradition. There's some things that we learned from our previous chapters that'll help us when we don't know what to do. And finally, when you hear the Lord giving you a strategy, even when it doesn't make sense, listen and surrender to the voice of God. And I come to declare to you, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men and women, the great things that God will do through you in this season. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Song is an affirmation that you can speak over your own life. It says, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Come on, y'all, let's go. Here we go. Goodness.
Goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days.
The days of my life.
Uh-huh. Goodness, come on, say it.
All of the days of my life.
Come on, say it again, everybody all over the world. Say,
goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days.
All of the days of my life.
That sounds good. Come on, goodness, say,
goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days. Come on, give me some harmony. Goodness and mercy, sing out.
Goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days.
All of the days of my life.
That sounds good. Come on, goodness, here we go.
Goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days. Come on, clap your hands, all ye people, real big.
Goodness and mercy follows me.
all of Monday. Come on, you say goodness. Come on.
Goodness and mercy follow me.
Oh. Come on, say it one more time. Goodness, just like that. Come on.
Goodness and mercy follow me.
Oh.
All of my days.
Come on, give it to me in harmony. Come on, real big.
Goodness and mercy follow me.
Oh.
All of my days.
Goodness and mercy, sing out.
Goodness and mercy follow me.
Oh.
All of my days.
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 Come on, let's go up. Come on, say.
Goodness and mercy follows me.
All of my days.
All of my days.
For the grace of God is on your life. And goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. God bless you.
We hope that you've enjoyed this week's worship services. May the grace and the love and peace of God be with you.
Praise